Recorded Books presents a griot audio production of The Madonna of Excelsior by Zakes Mda. This unabridged recording is narrated by Robin Miles and directed by Jenny Selig. This book is copyrighted 2002 by Zakes Mda. This recording is copyrighted 2007 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of griot audio, celebrating the best in contemporary African-American fiction and nonfiction. The author opens with the following note. On the 10th of May, 2000, together with the phalanx of my daughters, I visited Father Franz Klarhout at his studio in Free State. I had always wanted to meet him. He had mentored some artist friends of mine, James Dorothy in particular. Klarhout presented me with a book on his work written by Dirk and Dominique Schwager. But first, he painted a golden bird on the black flyleaf and signed his name. I dedicate this novel to the bird. And now, The Madonna of Excelsior.
Chapter 1. Women, Donkeys, and Sunflowers. All these things flow from the sins of our mothers. The land that lies flat on its back for kilometer after relentless kilometer. The black roads that run across it in different directions, slicing through one street platteland towns. The cosmos flowers that form a guard of honor for the lone motorist. White, pink, and purple petals. The sunflower fields that stretch as far as the eye can see. The land that is awash with yellowness and the brownness of the kokwa grass. Color explodes. Green, yellow, red, and blue. Sleepy-eyed women are walking among sunflowers. Naked women are chasing white doves among sunflowers. True atonement of rhythm and line. A boy is riding a donkey backwards among sunflowers. The ground is red. The sky is blue. The boy is red. The faces of the women are blue. Their hats are yellow and their dresses are blue. Women are harvesting wheat, or they are cutting the kokwa grass that grows near the fields along the road and is used for thatching houses. Big-breasted figures tower over the reapers, their ghostly faces showing only displeasure. People without feet and toes, all of them. These things leap at us in broad strokes, just as they leapt at Popi 25 years ago. Only then the strokes were simple and naive, just a black outline of figures with brown or green oil paint rubbed over them. Men in blankets and conical basutu heads pushing a cart that is drawn by a donkey. Topless women dancing in tetana skirts. Big hands and big breasts. That is one thing that has not changed, for Father Franz Klarhout is still a great admirer of big hands and big breasts. He is, after all, still the same trinity, man, priest, and artist. The threeness that has tamed the open skies, the vastness and the loneliness of the Free State. 25 years ago, Popi peered from her mother's back at the white man as he warmly and masterfully daubed his broad strokes. At 5, she was precocious enough to wonder why the houses were all so skewed and crowded together. She thought she could draw better houses. Her people, though she sketched on the sand in the backyard of her township home, were not distorted like the priests. They were matchstick figures with big heads and spiky hair, but they were not distorted. Yet his very elongated people overwhelmed her with joy. She saw herself jumping down from her mother's back and walking into the canvas, joining the distorted people in their daily chores. They filled her with excitement in their ordinariness. "Popi, we must go now," her mother said. "Awu, Niki, I am still watching, appealed Popi. She always called her mother by the name that everyone else in the township used. The father has no use for me, said Niki as she walked out of the gate of the mission station. Popi was sulking on her mother's back. She had wanted to stay with the distorted people in their skewed houses. We cannot waste time with your silliness, said Niki. She had a long way to go. She was going to hitchhike all the way back to the black township of Mahlatsweza in Excelsior, 30 kilometers from the Roman Catholic mission in Taba Ngu. Traffic was sparse on these roads. She knew that she would have to walk for miles before a truck would stop to give her a lift. Truck drivers were really the only people who felt sorry for hitchhikers. But trucks were few and far between on these provincial roads. She would have to walk for miles with only cosmos, the kokwa grass and sunflowers for company. Popi would be fast asleep on her back. Although her visit to Taba Ngu had not been a success, she was grateful that the priest had given her a few coins for her trouble. But she was disappointed that he had no use for her. She had heard from the women of his congregation that he painted naked women. In all the neighboring townships and villages, women walked out of their skewed houses to pose in the nude for him. He paid his models well. Niki had hoped that she would also be able to pose for him. But the priest had no need of a model. He was not in his nudes painting mode. He had a few canvases of distorted people and skewed houses and donkeys and sunflowers to complete. Then in a few weeks' time, he would be painting the Madonna subject. If Niki and Popi could come back then, he certainly would use them as models. The priest was captivated by Popi. He loved all children, even those who were emaciated and unkempt. Though Popi stayed on Niki's back all the time they were in his studio, he played with her, making all sorts of funny faces. Then he tore out a page from a magazine and shaped her a donkey. He gave it to her and pranced around the room, braying like a donkey. The stocky Trinity with his broad face and snow-white mane brayed and brayed, and Popi laughed and laughed. All this time, Niki was nervous. She knew that the priest must have been wondering why Popi was so different from other children, why she was so light in complexion, why her eyes were blue, and why she had flowing locks. We who know the story of Excelsior do not wonder. As Niki trudged the black road until she became one with it, Popi's mind wandered back to the man who loved women, donkeys and sunflowers, and to his creations. Woman and girl melted into God's own canvas. Chapter 2. The Garden Party. Popi tells us that it all began when the Trinity was nourished by Flemish expressionists. Theirs were ordinary subjects, sympathetic men and women living ordinary lives and performing ordinary rituals. Popi knows all these things and shares them with all those who care to listen. We suspect that there are many other things that she knows but keeps to herself. And there are others that she has decided not to remember. 25 years ago, she saw the thin outlines that defined the concertina player and the dancers. At the time, she knew nothing about Flemish expressionists. She hadn't experienced, through the broad pages of colorful coffee table books, the mystique that embodied protest. She was only 5. And she was with Niki. The strokes were not broad like today's strokes. The Trinity had not started with broad strokes. They got thicker and rougher as he became more comfortable in his own style. The strokes Popi saw did not stand out. The surface was smoother. The finish was grainy. The colours were fruity. Thick fingers like bunches of bananas pressed the concertina keys. White and brown strokes marked the folds of the instrument as it breathed heavily in and out. The musician's hat was an overripe tomato. Brown hair peeped under the brim. He was intent. The song had drawn his eyes into his skin, and they had become brown slits. His long nose was sunburnt. He squeezed the concertina. It squealed. Men and women danced. Full-figured women in starking apple dresses, skirts of golden pears and Granny Smith's, pink blouses, out-of-step men in brown hats and brown suits, or in light blue shirts and green pants, sleepy-eyed men with big, groping hands. The musicians squeezed the instrument, and it wailed a graceful valse. Men and women floated on the clouds. Then he squeezed a lively fastrop. Quicker, quicker than the valse. He was playing Yapi Laubscher's O Weihenhuis, the famous composition about an old barn. The zestful party danced in a circle. The men's arms were around the women's waists. The women's arms were around the men's shoulders, feet close together, turning on the same spot in a fast tiki-dry. Rosy-cheeked girls in pink dresses screeched their laughter under the architrave. Then they ran to the lawn to make a nuisance of themselves to the boys who were playing with a rugby ball, practicing throws that might see them being picked for Hack Freestadt or even the Springboks in later years. There were no flowers in the garden, just the lawn and the small shrubs that would one day grow into a hedge along the short wrought iron fence. The girls chased one another among the boys. The boys didn't take kindly to this. They chased the girls away until they disappeared behind the whitewashed house. The house was an imperfect copy of an English bungalow, but it was more exuberant than an English bungalow, as exuberant as the fruity dancers. Two bay windows with ornate stained glass on each side of the brown double doors, which also had painted glass panels. Purple columns supporting the purple architrave. Pillars whose crude capitals were halfway between Ionic and Corinthian. The roof was green. It was made of corrugated iron sheets instead of tiles. Purple gutters. Green and white chimneys on opposite ends, one with a cowl and another one with a television aerial attached to it. Television was only a few months old in South Africa. This house, therefore, belonged to a man who not only had the money for such novelties, but was also determined to set the trends. The Boere music of the concertina was relentless. The leakies, or tunes, were getting louder. The folkspieler, or dances, were getting exaggerated as the concertina filled the dancers with even higher spirits. It had something to do with the cherry liqueur. The circle of buoyant, rounded figures danced in and out of the wide doors. Niki passed the time by trying to identify each of the revelers. Popi couldn't be bothered. She was busy sketching houses on the sand just outside the gate. She was concentrating very hard, determined that her houses would not be skewed like those she had seen at the Trinity studio a week before. Her houses would stand straight. Niki knew almost all the revelers. There was Sergeant Clenion Lombard with his voluminous wife, Liesel, stomping the ground as if they were in a military drill. He, of the South African police, who also acted as a prosecutor at the magistrate's court. She, of the yellow cherry jam that had made her famous throughout the entire district. There was Cruetion Lombard, Clenion's doddering father. There was the Reverend Francois Bonman, the dominie of the local Dutch Reformed Church, dancing with a woman Niki could not identify, as she had her back turned most of the time. The dominie One marble eye from a gun accident 5 years ago was not in his usual black suit and white tie, but in a brown safari suit. There was Johannes Smith, a very prosperous and very hirsute farmer with a beer belly. He didn't have a partner. And of course, there was pint-sized Adam de Vries and his strong-boned wife, Lisette. This was their house. This was their garden party. Adam de Vries ran a small law practice in addition to being the mayor of Excelsior. Like most of the revelers present, he prided himself on the fact that his grandfather had been one of the founders of this town back in 1911. It had been established on an old farm called Excelsior. People came from surrounding farms to settle here, and since then, various members of his family have worn the dynastic mayoral chain. Except on a few occasions when there was no clear candidate from the family, like when the late and lamented butcher, Stefanus Kronje, became the mayor. More families of farmers and businessmen were arriving, all pillars of the local Afrikaner community, the very cream of Excelsior society, and of other nearby towns such as Tweespruit, Brandfort, and Fakir de Vlei. Niki could see their old Beckys or trucks and veteran Chevrolets approach on the 1 kilometer stretch of road that was lined with black ironbark blue gum trees on both sides. Then the cars would disappear, masked by Reverend Bornman's church that looked like hands in prayer, only to appear again on Adam de Vries's street behind the church. They parked in the street, and the visitors walked in through the gate without giving Niki and Popi a second glance. They joined the sitias, a much slower dance than both the vals and the fustrip. Even with the fuel of the cherry liqueur, the dancers had become languid and the laughter louder. The rugby-playing children had increased in number and the garden was becoming too small for them. A boy threw the ball too hard. The catcher failed to catch it. It dropped in the street and bounced until it stopped in front of Popi and Niki. The catcher ran out of the gate to get the ball. Niki knew him immediately. Chart Kronje. She hadn't seen him since he was 7. Since the days when he used to insist on being carried on her back, even though he was ridiculously big for that mode of transportation. She would indulge him, because he was such a respectful boy. But she stopped when she realized that whenever he was strapped in a shawl on her back, he induced an erection and worked himself up with unseemly rhythmic movements. All that time the boy had been pretending to play horsey-horsey. He had in fact been in venereal heaven at her expense. Now here he was, a gangly lad of 12. Chart took the ball and threw it to Popi. "Getch," he said. Popi missed it. Chart laughed. She ran after the ball and got it. Instead of throwing it, she walked to him and handed it back. He looked at her closely, and then at Niki. It was obvious that he no longer remembered who Niki was. 5 years can be a lifetime in the memory of a boy. Also, her face had changed. The chocolate-smooth complexion was now marred by black, brown, and reddish chubaba patches. "Why are you sitting here?" Chart asked. "I was hoping to get the bones, or any leftovers, after the party," she said haltingly. "Something for me and my little girl." "Your little girl? This can't be your child," said Chart. "She looks like a hotnut child, like a boozman. You must have stolen her." Then he ran back to his rugby game. But soon he came back with a slice of cake, broke it into two, and gave a piece to Niki and another one to Popi. The woman who was dancing with the dominie saw him and hurried to the gate. For the first time, Niki got a good look at her. She was face to face with Cornelia Kronje, Chart's mother. 5 years had changed her. She looked old and tired. Cornelia recognized Niki, too, and glared at her. Niki glared back, straight into Cornelia's eyes. Niki didn't cringe. She did not cast her eyes down, as was expected of her. Cornelia laughed. It sounded hollow and crude, not rich and full-bodied, like the laughter Niki knew when she worked for Cornelia all those years ago. Then deadly anger flashed in Cornelia's eyes. "What the hell do you want here?" she asked. "I can be here, Madame Cornelia," said Niki calmly. "It is not your house. I never go to your house."
"Shut!" cried Cornelia. "What are you doing with these people? Come back here at once."
Chart looked at his mother and at Niki and Popi. He walked back to the rugby game. Chapter 3. All These Madonnas. Madonnas all around, exuding tenderness. Burnt amber mother in a blue shirt, squatting in a field of yellow ochre wheat. Burnt sienna baby wrapped in white lace, resting between her thighs. Mother with a gaping mouth, big oval eyes, naked breast dangling above the baby's head. Flaky blue suggesting a halo. Unhampered bonding of mother and child and wheat. Brown Madonnas with big breasts. A naked Madonna lying on a bed of white flowers. Her eyes are closed and her lips are twisted. Her voluptuous thighs are wide open, ready to receive drops of rain. A black pubic forest hides her nakedness. Her breasts are full and her nipples are hard. Under her arm, she carries a baby wrapped in white lace. A naked Madonna holds a naked child against a blue moon on a purple sky. The mother is kissing the back of the child's head. Another Madonna kneels, her head resting on the ground near the child in white lace, and her buttocks opening up to the sky, ready to receive drops of rain. The fattest of the Madonnas stands among red flowers, looking at yellow fields that cover large patches of the red and brown and green land, and that stretch for kilometers until they meet a blue and white sky. The Madonna of the cosmos and sunflowers and open skies. Like all the others, she is naked. Tightly to her chest, she holds a baby wrapped in white lace. After 25 years, these naked Madonnas still live. Popi tells us that they will live forever because such things never die. So will her memory of the excited Trinity surrounded by canvases of naked Madonnas on easels, with a naked Niki sitting on a stool holding a naked Popi. Popi thought these Madonnas looked nothing like Popi and Niki of the flesh, even though Popi and Niki of the flesh had modeled for them. There were distortions of Popi and Niki of the flesh. It didn't matter to Niki that the Trinity failed to capture their real images. It was boom time for Madonnas. Mother and child had been modeling every day for a month. Mother and child would not need to sit outside another garden party for a long time. Initially, Niki had been embarrassed to be seen naked by this old white man. But the Trinity was gentle. At first, he allowed her to pose fully clothed, as he painted the Madonna in a blue shirt, and the blue mother, the one with the angelic face and flowing locks like Popi's, holding a baby who wore nothing but white socks. Then the Trinity eased Niki into taking her clothes off. She cringed in shame, but when she remembered the mortifying garden party, her garments fell on the floor one by one, until her smooth body glowed before him in all its glorious blackness. It was not the first time a white man had seen her naked. But this one was different. He didn't seem to see her nakedness, even though he painted it. Chapter 4. In the very beginning, there were three naive girls. Here in the Free State, the sky is big. A red sun oozes out of the sky. It drips down on the yellow fields. It melts everything it touches, eliciting a feast of color. 35 years ago, the sky was just as big. The sun dripped on the yellow fields. Color ran amok. But the Trinity's world was of dark and somber tonal values, charcoal on white, figures in tight embraces, naked women being observed by floating heads, flowing figures in squiggles that become lace, three birds of prey perched on the naked buttocks of a woman, naive women and children in a naive black and white world, a world of sinless doodles. Even then, the Trinity's was clearly a male gaze. We do not forget that one of his threeness is a man. Three naive girls walked out of the Trinity's naive world. Each carried an empty sisal sack. They walked among the cosmos flowers that grew between the fields and on the edge of the road. They had no cares in the world and were singing and humming joyously. They sang about the red railway bus that took fathers, brothers, and lovers to the gold mines of Velcom, leaving only the dust in Excelsior. Every time the girls came across dry cow dung, they picked it up and put it in their sacks and moved on in a rhythmic step in time to their song. One of the girls was Niki. She was 18 years old and looked pretty as a doll in her brown pleated terraline skirt and white frilly blouse. The only outfit she owned both for happy and sad days. She wore blue rubber sandals that we called flops because of the noise they made, especially when one was walking fast. Her body had the fullness of the moon. We thought she was blooming into such a unique flower, and we exclaimed so whenever we saw her. A rare flower in the middle of the desert that was Maratsuetsa location. Her skin was chocolate brown and smooth. It was not glossy, for she applied Pandora matte cream generously, which gave her face a ghostly finish. Her hair was rich and sheeny. Only the previous night she had used a red-hot stone to straighten it. Niki was the only one dressed in her Sunday best. She had just returned from church when her two friends, Amampe and Maria, came to ask her to join them in a cow dung collecting expedition. She didn't hesitate, because she was running out of the essential dung that was used as fuel to cook food and warm the single-room corrugated iron shack she shared with her father. Also, such expeditions were great fun. Girls got to enjoy the freedom of the big sky and to share the latest tidbits on the ups and downs of boy-girl relationships. Bees were swarming on a bush, and the naive girls kept their distance, even though next to the bush was a pile of dry dung. Swarming bees could be dangerous if they were disturbed. These were contemplating creating new brood chambers under the rocks next to the bush, so as to be near the nectar and the pollen of the sunflowers and cosmos. "Yay!" screeched Amampe. "What is it?" asked Niki. "You want to provoke the bees?" cried Maria at the same time.
"Hairy buttocks," said Amampe softly.
It was Johannes Smith. He had materialized before them with a whip in his hand. He cracked it and laughed. Niki was scared. She wanted to run away, but the squat, hairy gorilla blocked her way. Amampe and Maria giggled. They had played this game with Johannes Smith before. Niki only knew of the game from fireside stories. She was not looking forward to it. She had heard of white farmers whose great sport was to waylay black girls in the fields. They chased them around and played harrowing games with them. She had never experienced these games herself, and now it seemed it was her turn. Hairy Buttocks was standing in front of her, brandishing a whip. She knew Johannes Smith vaguely as the farmer her father sometimes worked for. Her father was a handyman who did peace jobs for the farmers and traders in the district. The hirsute man with a beer belly smiled benevolently, searched the pockets of his khaki shirt, then of his khaki shorts, fished out some banknotes, and gave the girls 1 rand each. Niki hesitated. But when she saw her friends gleefully grabbing the money, she took it too. Johannes Smith gave Niki another 1 rand note. "This is for your mother," he said in Sesotho. Niki took it, even though she expected Johannes Smith to know that her mother had died many years ago. Surely her father must have told him when working for him. He gave her yet another 1 rand note. "This is for your father." The two naive girls gave Niki knowing winks. "He wants you," whispered Amampe. Johannes Smith cracked the whip in Nikki's direction. "Follow me," he commanded. Niki just froze.
"Don't be foolish, Niki," said Maria. "He will give you more money."
"Then why don't you go with him yourself?" asked Niki.
"He wants you, not me," said Maria. "He chose you," added Amampe.
Johannes Smith grabbed Niki by the arm and dragged her into the sunflower field.
"You wait there and whistle if you see people approaching," he barked to the two girls.
Deep in the sunflower field, Johannes Smith pulled off Nikki's tear-lean skirt. She tried to hold on to it, but he had the strength of 10 demons. He threw her on the damp ground. Then he pulled down her panties and took them off. He sniffed them, which seemed to raise more demons in his quivering body. He stuffed the panties in his pocket. Yellowness ran amok. Yellowness dripped down with her screams. He slapped her and ordered her to shut up. Her screams were now muffled with his hand on her mouth. His pants were at his ankles. He lay on top of her and pleaded. "I am sorry. I didn't mean to hurt you. But if you make noise, people will come and spoil our fun." Niki wept softly as his hardness touched her thighs. Intense heat sucked out his slimy seed before he could penetrate her. He cursed his pipe as it leaked all over her. He damned its sudden limpness. He just lay there like a plastic bag full of decaying tripe on top of her. She heaved him off her body and jumped up. She grabbed her skirt and ran like a tornado, destroying a swath of sunflowers in her wake. Johannes Smith's accomplices called after her, "Niki, Niki, wait for us!" At home, she got under the blankets and cried for a long time until she fell asleep. She woke when her father arrived in the evening, drunk as usual. He was fuming because she had not cooked any food. She tried to explain that she was not feeling well. And in any case, there was no food to cook because he had not left her any money. But he was not prepared to listen to any lame excuses. He was going to beat the laziness out of her. He was going to lash her buttocks with a belt until they were sour. To placate him, she ran to the tuck shop and used Johannes Smith's money to buy her father a loaf of bread and a big can of pilchards in tomato sauce. There was a lot of change left over. Maria and Amampe came the following day. They were eager to lap up every morsel of gossip.
How did things go with hairy buttocks? Maria wanted to know.
At first, Niki did not want to speak to them. She accused them of being traitors. They must have knowingly led her into a trap. They, of course, denied having been Hairy Buttocks' agents. They babbled with excitement until they melted her anger.
Did it enter?
Asked a mumpy.
No, it just...
The two girls shook the corrugated iron shack with shrieks of laughter.
It never enters, said Emampi. His desire is only in the heart, explained Maria, but his manhood always fails him.
It happens like that with all the girls he has seduced with money, said Emampi.
Perhaps we should call him Limp Stick in addition to Hairy Buttocks, suggested Maria.
Or Sleeping Horn, said Emampi.
Lame Horn,
Horn of Sorrow.
Niki was not amused.
I am going to report him, she cried. I am going to tell the police about what he has done to me.
Don't be foolish, Niki, admonished Emampi. Do you think the police will believe you had nothing to do with it? You took his money, didn't you?
They will arrest you and charge you with the Immorality Act. Haven't you heard of black women who are in jail for sleeping with white men?
But he forced me. You were there. You saw it happen.
He will deny everything, said Emampi. And we didn't see either. We were not in the sunflower field with you.
Don't be stupid, Niki. You can make a lot of money from this foolish white man. Just give him what he wants and eat the money.
For sure he'll be back, added Maria, laughing.
Just take the money and let the man water your thighs.
He came back that very afternoon. A child came in and said there was a white man in a battered baki outside, looking for Nikki's father.
Tell him he is not here, said Niki. He can go and search for him in all the shebeens of this location.
The child came back again.
He is calling you.
Tell him to go to hell. But Johannes Smith did not go to hell. He walked into the shack instead.
What do you want? Asked Niki.
I am returning your books, said Johannes Smith, throwing her panties at her. She did not catch them. They fell on the cow dung floor.
If you try anything, I'll scream, threatened Niki.
Is that the way to welcome your lover? Demanded Johannes Smith. He leapt at her. She jumped away and ran out of the door. Johannes Smith was a persistent man. His offers of cash mounted with her stubbornness until her good friends prevailed on her. After all, it would not enter, they assured her. A full stomach at bedtime and new leather shoes under the bed would be worth the filth on her thighs. She relented. On every occasion in the yellow fields, she just lay there and became a masturbation gadget. Then she went home and secretly wept while she bathed him off her body. But he was an obstinate stain. To his utter amazement one day, he entered her, rapturing and hemorrhaging her maidenhood. He howled that he was dying such a beautiful death. She tried to vomit him out. Only the last meal and bitter bile came out. For many days she tried. For many days, only half-digested food came out. She vowed, never again. His thirst for her could not be quenched, while she imagined the most cruel death for him. Chapter 5. The Wedding. The bride is in turquoise, kerf-length taffeta. The scrappy palette knife-created white lace that hangs from her head right down to her powder-blue shoes makes her look very delicate. She wears a crown of purple and white cosmos blooms. A shoeless, full-figured woman is giving the bride a cuddle. She is saved from total nakedness by a pink giant cosmos that covers her jewel like Eve's leaf of shame. Another giant cosmos grows out of the fissure of her buttocks. She also wears a crown of cosmos. Big feet. At last, the toes. The round-eyed groom is in brown overalls and yellow woolen cap. His face is well-fed and is round like his eyes. He steps gingerly on the yellow ochre mud in his black rubber boots. A naked bridesmaid embraces him tightly. Her thick thigh is raised to his stomach. Another naked bridesmaid is tickling his ear with a pink cosmos. Full figures, round stomachs. Each of the women wears a white lace veil that flows to the ground and has pink cosmos attached to it. The frills are tattered. The women's bare feet are attached to elephantiasis legs. They stamp on the yellow ochre mud with stern dignity. They, too, have toes. Three blue moons shine out of a violet sky. Earlier that morning, vows were made and papers were signed before the minister, who had taken the opportunity to complain about the leaking roof of the church and the tight-fistedness of his congregation. Now, opposing sides stamped on the yellow ochre mud. It had rained all morning. Rain always came with blessings. The wedding was blessed. Girls and boys from the groom's side sang of the blessings. But the blessings were wasted, they lamented tunefully, as the handsome Pule was marrying this Niki, who was world famous for her laziness. The beautiful, round-faced Pule was going to die of hunger as soon as he set up house with this clumsy Niki. They danced around the blessed couple as they heaped scorn on the bride. Boys and girls from the bride's side responded with their own musical derision. Pule, they sang, was so ugly that when he walked out of the house at midday, the sun was bound to set and the world would be covered in darkness. His was the ugliness that banished the light of day. How could Pule think that he deserved a Seponono, a woman of soaring beauty and dimpled smiles, like Niki? For the whole day, the bride and the groom's parties threw verbal mud at each other. Each side had spent every evening for one whole month practicing new songs that would excel in mocking the other side. Biting songs under a fluttering white flag that had announced the wedding for weeks in advance. After thoroughly disparaging each other, both parties settled down in an old red and white marquee and shared mutton, samp, beetroot, ginger beer and cookies. Boys and girls exchanged addresses. Other weddings could result, since weddings gave birth to more weddings, just like funerals. In the whites-only pub of Excelsior Hotel, Johannes Smith drank himself silly and cried real tears into his frothy beer. That evening, Pule took his new bride to her new home, a brand new shack built of shimmering corrugated iron sheets a few streets from the old shack she had shared with her drunken father. On a moseme grass mat, the only furnishing in the house, he spread layers of blankets, grey, purple and fawn. She sank into the store-smelling softness. While the song of the bridesmaids jibed and taunted outside, she sucked him in. He danced inside her like a whirlwind, until they both exploded. The hollowness that had existed since the yellowness dripped with her screams was filled. The stubborn stain was bleached away. Once more, she was whole. Once more, she belonged to herself. And she gave herself permission to share herself with someone else. The following day, Pule boarded the red railway bus back to Velkom, there to be drained by the gold that he extracted from the dust of the depths of the earth. Johannes Smit continued to be a slave to his secret desires. She shooed him away. His unrequited shadow dogged her path. It loomed large, even when she got a job at Excelsior Slachhuis, Stefanus Kronje's butchery. She was one of five women who kept the butchery clean, cut the meat, weighed it, and generally served the customers. But of course, none of them were allowed near the till. Cornelia Kronje herself, Madame Cornelia to Niki and the other girls, sat behind the till. Sometimes her husband, Stefanus Kronje, manned it. Niki's special assignment involved acting as a nanny to young Chart Kronje, in addition to her work at the butchery. Johannes Smit took to buying meat at odd times and made a point of being served by Niki. When his deep freeze was full of meat, he took to visiting Stefanus Kronje at work, even though everyone knew that their politics had taken divergent routes. Stefanus Kronje was the secretary of the local branch of the ruling National Party and the mayor of Excelsior. Johannes Smit had recently abandoned the National Party to join the breakaway Herstichte National Party, an ultra-conservative political grouping of those Afrikaners who felt that their formerly beloved National Party had become too soft and liberal toward blacks and was beginning to relax some of the more stringent but God-given apartheid laws. Stefanus Kronje thought Johannes Smit was beginning to regret the errors of his ways and wanted to return to the fold. He did not notice that during these visits, Johannes Smit always tried to catch Niki's eye and would then furtively wave some banknotes at her. Niki would ignore him. She continued to ignore him when he followed her and the other women in his battered Becky on their way back to Malatswitsa after knocking off work. These women, who sometimes included Emampe and Maria, knew all about hairy buttocks and took his misery as something that enriched their lives with laughter. Niki, on the other hand, found this attention irritating. Inside her, another life was ticking. She wanted to think only of its expected kicks in a few months' time, and not of things that reminded her of her humiliation. Blue and red dominate. Three women are surrounded by white light. White against a blue wall and a blue skewed window. One has a blue face and wears a blue duke on her head and a blue shawl over her shoulders. The second woman has a red face with tinges of grey. She wears red lipstick and a red and blue blanket. A blue woolen cap sits on her head. The third woman has a black face and red eyes from which flow red tears. She wears a red t-shirt and a red beret. The three women are standing next to the bed on which recline the figures of a blue-faced woman and a newly born baby. Both she and the baby wear blue woolen caps. Their heads rest peacefully on a fluffy white pillow. The mother is covered in a red and blue blanket, and the baby is in white. Next to the bed is a side table on which rests a red clay pot and a white bottle. The mother and child are fast asleep, while the three women stand guard over them. The baby boy was Viliki, a product of whirlwinds and explosions. Chapter 6. She is holding the sun. She is holding the sun entwined in her arms. It is blazing red, with streaks of yellow. She is all impasto black and blue and yellow. The sun glows through her body, giving it patches of fluorescent red. She sits like a Buddha, embracing the sun. She is wide awake, for night has passed. The whites of her eyes are milky white, and the pupils are black like the night. Everything around her is fiery red. The sky is red. The ground is red. Rivers of white run on the red ground. Broad strokes. She is dark and sinister and beautiful. Under her impasto sun, plants are wilting. Johannes Smith was distracted by an infernal drought that was incinerating parts of the Free State, and the aphids that were having a field day on his spring wheat crop. These destructive partners were surely going to lessen the yield. An average of only 4 bags per hectare instead of the usual 8. Subterranean rivers were drying up, and the veldt was turning into a smouldering desert. A westerly wind was blowing, a sure sign that the drought was in no hurry to go. To add to his woes, a freak hailstorm hit the area, causing further damage to his crop. Like Johannes Smith, all the farmers in the district were crying. And when the farmers cried, the people of Mahlatsweza cried too. Their livelihoods depended on the grace of weather. Perhaps in December the rains would come, a promise of a good maize harvest. In the meantime, farmers shed what they consider to be excess workforce. Johannes Smith focused on how he was going to repay the land bank loan and forgot about Niki. Niki survived the scorching sun because Chart had grown addicted to her back. Viliki toddled by her side. Viliki wondered why he was not the one strapped on his mother's back. Why the big white boy, 5 times his size, was the one riding his mother and shouting, "Horsey, horsey!" Chapter 7. The Pan. There is nothing muted about these reds and yellows and blues. An impasto world glares at you noisily. But this is not the kind of noise that turns your insides. It is not discordant. It does not grate on the eye. It is a saintly noise. People walk out of the skewed houses that form a circle. A blue church completes the circle. The houses are pink with cobalt blue doors. People are floating to the church. People with black faces, each holding a giant white flower. Blank faces. A man in a crimson jumpsuit, brown shoes, and brown conical basutu hat. A woman in a crimson dress and brown beret. She has no feet. A man in a pink jumpsuit and brown woolen cap. Footless women in blue skirts and red blouses. Their faces are just black blobs. A woman in a long white dress and white veil leads the procession into the church. The procession glides augustly on the raw sienna path. Blazing light surrounds the solemn procession, absorbing the devout into a halo of yellowness. 3 giant white flowers grow in front of the church. The blue tower is capped by a black spire that pierces the purple sky into heaven. The sky has streaks of pink and yellow clouds, and a dull yellow ochre sun with a broad black outline. We saw Niki walk past the church. Viliki was trudging behind her. 3-year-old Viliki, all spruced up in his black shorts and khaki shirt and shoeless feet that had acquired a pink color after being freshly scrubbed to remove thick layers of black dirt. Niki was well scrubbed herself. At 22, she drowned the hearts of Mahlatsweza in a vortex of desire. But she was unreachable. She could not save them from certain death. She was Pule's wife, Pule, whose very name spoke of many rains. Old Pule, who had been married before, and was deserted. Or did he desert? Shame. Niki was loved so much. You could see it even from the way she walked. Like someone who is loved. Shame. She had a husband who dressed her so well. She glowed in a red two-piece costume with blinding silver buttons and a tailor-made cream-white blouse. Her face glowed from Super Rose skin lightening lotion. She had long discarded the cheaper Pandora mat. One of the perks of being married to a man who burrowed in the earth for the white man's gold. Her hair gleamed with braids of very thin lines, a style known as essence because it was first seen on models that appeared in an African-American magazine called Essence. Shame. Pule spoilt his young, beautiful wife. There was no way she could dress herself and braid her hair like that from her earnings at Excelsior Slachwis. We all knew how tight-fisted the boors of Excelsior were. This was our church. It was Nikki's church. She belonged here. As she passed, she could hear seeping through the porous walls a hymn about God's amazing grace that distinguished itself by its sweetness. If she had been inside, she would also be singing about the amazing grace, while Viliki would be snuffing out with his little thumb termites that traced their path across the aisle up the pew in front of him. She would slap his hand and he would stop. But soon the massacre would resume. Viliki was always bored by solemnity. She knew by heart what would follow the hymn. The minister would speak of how the meek would inherit the earth, and the poor in spirit would see the kingdom of heaven. How those who were oppressed and persecuted would get their reward in heaven. They were the salt of the earth and the light of the world. But in the meantime, he would plead while they were still on earth, preparing for their inheritance in heaven. It was necessary that the leaking roof of the house of the Lord be repaired. Was it because of the congregation's meanness of spirit that even though over the years appeals had been made for funds to repair the roof, very little had been raised? How did the congregation think the Lord felt about being praised in a dilapidated building with a leaking roof and cracked walls with peeling paint? The congregation would respond with amens, but only small brown coins would find their way into the collection plate. It was like that every Sunday. Today, Niki was going to another church, the one in town, a distance of 20 minutes at an easy pace, 15 minutes if she didn't have someone slowing her down. The Reverend François Bonman's beautiful church, built of sandstone and roofed with black slate. Everyone said it was shaped like hands in prayer, but Niki did not see any of that. Often she had tried to work out how exactly the strange architecture translated into hands in anything, let alone prayer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.